to your feet. You don't have to jump. You can just stand like a normal person. I don't know why I'm expecting everyone to do a hop. Oh, it is so good to be with you this morning, whether you've joined us in the room or whether you're online. It is great to see you. You've picked a really good morning. We've got Celebration Sunday this morning. Yeah. You'll find out a little bit more about that later, so I'll leave you hanging in suspense if you don't know what that is. But we're going to start the morning the way we want to. We're going to celebrate and declare the name of Jesus. So let's sing together.
We celebrate life every time we gather, and that's the honor we have as children of Jesus Christ and the Father. So I just want to say to you today, if you're here, if you're joining us online, or if you're here in the room, we're celebrating today. We're celebrating our senior leaders, Dave and Helen. We're celebrating 25 years of leadership. Honestly, you've come at a good time. You really have. Do you know, here at today's Community Church, we have six core values. And you're not going to see them on a wall, but I pray that you experience and encounter them in this community. And these core values are discipleship, the mission, the leadership, the generosity, honor, and excellence. And you'll see these core values threaded throughout Scripture. But we have had the privilege here in Wigan, in today's community church, to have two incredible leaders who have modeled and lived this out for us. And so we thank you both so much for the spiritual transformation you have brought to us as individuals, as a town, and beyond. And this is to celebrate and honor you. So you're in for a real treat. Welcome to those online and in the room. I don't know, but I don't know what kind of marks the Christmas season for you. Is it the advert for Coca-Cola, like, holidays are coming? Is that like your Christmas vibe? Is it the adverts that you see, like, what is John Lewis going to do today? What useless thing are we gonna buy because we want to, you know, be a part of the story? Who put the Christmas tree up? Give me a wave. Who's got their tree up? Okay, you guys need to go see my husband because for some reason I have to wait for the first. But, no! So next week, Sunday, everyone say next week. On the 5th, we are kicking off the festive season here at today's community church. We have got Christmas on the big screen. Yes, we do. We're going to be showing a movie called Stickman straight after the gathering. You can stay, bring your lunch. There's going to be free cotton candy. Honestly, we're about to kick it off. So join us, because for the next couple of Sundays, we're going to have some real Christmas treats in store for you. Now, we're going to have two videos that I'm going to ask you to watch. The first one is really about how we as a community are really engaging with Christmas and bringing hope to every single home in the town of Wigan. And so watch that video and see how you can get involved. But the second video, give me a wave if you're new. If you're new here with us in the room, great to see you. Now, we're going to watch this video, and if you're new, there's some information for you. But we also have a treat. So there's going to be a time to respond, so don't miss that so that you can get your treat. Let's just watch the video. Thanks, guys.
So we want to tell you a bit about our Christmas plans this year. So at the Community Grocery, we're now reaching nearly 1,000 members. And it's been really great this year to be able to be supporting so many families across Wigan, many of whom we know have been able to really benefit from being able to access food at a much lower cost. And we've heard several members say how the grocery has been a lifeline for them in 2021. So this Christmas, we want to spread hope even further to our families. We will be opening a Christmas pop-up shop for 1 week in December, which all our members will have the opportunity to come down, fill up a Christmas basket full of decorations, treats, and toys. So to do this, we really need your support. There's a few ways that you can help. So firstly is by giving financially. We're expecting that we have about 500 families coming to get their Christmas basket. With each basket averaging about £10, that means we need £5,000 for 500 families across Wigan. So secondly, we're asking for donations of items. This includes Christmas toys, Christmas decorations, and Christmas food. To drop off these donations, they can be dropped off at the gathering on the Sunday or at the grocery during the week. So here are some key dates to remember. From the 13th to the 17th of December is when the pop-up shop will be open, and we would love your prayers for all our members who are going to visit during that week. Secondly is the 8th of December. That will be our deadline for all financial donations and donations of items. So we have called this Hope for Every Home, and that's what we want to see for every grocery member that visits our Christmas pop-up shop, that it will be a place that they can find hope this Christmas. So will you stand with us in prayer for that? And would you also consider how you can give towards this?
Good morning, my name's Gavin. It is so great to see you here today. If you're new, why don't you stick your hand up, because our welcome team who are around the arena have got a special gift just for you. It's like a little goodie bag thing going on. I don't even know what's in there. I might get one myself, actually. And if you join us online, again, we are so happy that you're with us. In the chat feed right now, a link's just popped up. You can click that and it'll take you to our digital welcome pack. You can find out a little bit more about what goes on in the life of our church. But for now, if you're in the arena or if you're online, let's give it up for our new people. We have an amazing kids' church here. But if you have a child up to the age of 2 who isn't quite old enough for kids' church yet, we have the gallery. And in the gallery, there's feeding areas, there's soft toys, but also we have a live link to the gathering, what you see here right now. So if your child's getting a little bit restless, then why don't you go ahead and use that when you're ready? And if you're having any trouble finding it or need some help getting there, just ask our welcome team. Throughout the week, we have a thing called community groups. Now, these are amazing little small gatherings all centered around an activity. So that could be sports, dog walking, creativity, book clubs, Bible studies, you name it, there's probably a group out there for you. They're a great place to make new friends, and also we can learn to follow Jesus just that little bit better. If you want to find out about the different groups we've got going on, go to the hub after the gathering or visit our website. We believe there's great blessing that comes from honouring God with our wealth, and we want to be a house of generosity, and there are so many amazing generous people in this house today. So with that, you are free to give. Whether that's a tithe or a generous offering, there are a number of ways you can do that. You can use the details on screen to give on your mobile device. You can fill out an envelope on the seats and then hand it in at the hub after the gathering. And for you guys watching online, you can find the link in the chat feed that goes directly to our online giving page. If you're a UK taxpayer, you may be eligible for gift aid. This means we can get an extra 25p for every pound you give from the government, but be sure to register for that when you give. You could also consider making your giving regular by setting up a standing order, and then that way it makes it as easy as possible. So the best way of keeping up to date with everything TCC is on our social media channels. You can learn more about the community growth we've got going on here, Postcode, Live Free, Kids Church, there's so much great stuff on there. Make sure that you follow, that you like, you share, and subscribe. Well, that's enough of me. We're gonna get back to the gathering now. But before I go, we have a great saying here at today's Community Church, which is, we want to create an irresistible environment where people can find their way back to God, and we really do pray that over your life today.
Hello.
Hey-o.
Good morning, everybody. How are we all doing? Good. It's so nice to see lots of faces and lots of very fabulously well-dressed people this morning. I see the effort you've made. We are here now in this section to speak to the people that we're here for, the people that we're celebrating this morning. And, you know, whether you know it or not, David and Helen have had an impact on your life. If you are sat in this room, they have cultivated a culture. They have listened to God. They have made big decisions and they have given their lives so that you and the generations before you and the generations after you might experience God the way that they have, as well as trying to make Wigan a fantastic place and really build it up. And you know Dave. You definitely know Dave's face, but you might not know Helen's as much. She doesn't love being on stage, but let me tell you what, these last 25 years, Dave and Helen have led this church together, and we are going to celebrate them. So on your feet and welcome them as they join us on stage this morning. David and Helen Belfield, everybody. You can take your seats.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for agreeing to do this, first of all, for us to interview. And just to say, we've got kids release in a little bit. We really wanted the opportunity for our kids' church volunteers to be here to hear some of the stories David and Helen might share, and obviously for the kids to see it too. So, how are you both?
We're here. Yeah, we're good. Okay. I'm good. Are you good? Yeah, I'm good.
Yeah. Excellent. We've got four balloons for you here.
So oh, there's brilliant. No thank you so much. Spent. No expense spared. I love it.
Okay.
Excellence
sorry.
Personified. Yeah. Come on.
All right. So let's just jump straight into it. So when we look back over your 25 years leading the church community, can you just share two or three standout moments that have happened over that period.
Went fast, didn't it? You gonna go? Yeah, go on, you talk. No, you talk. I always talk, you talk.
That's right, come on.
All right, okay, I'll go first then. All right, so honestly, I don't wanna be super cheesy, but I started thinking about standout moments, and there's so many, aren't you? You just kind of think of your life and think of there's loads of stuff. But the kind of first thing I wanna say is the standout moment is like loads of moments. And that was just watching my kids at certain points grow up in this community. You know, it's just like, just certain moments, their baptisms, their, you know, just like you've got kids and you see those. They've just been incredible moments for us, seeing our kids in this environment. It's been amazing.
And your grandkids now as well.
And grandkids, yeah, she's wonderful. Of course.
Yeah. What about you, Helen? What's one of your standout moments?
Right, Dave says he can remember lots. You know, I can't remember anything.
I can't remember what I did last week, so honestly, I'm sure there's been lots, but I wrote down that today will be a standout moment, and that is probably because, not just today, but every week, you just see so many people come in, finding God, and just being part of this community. And it's not just, you know, it's people of all ages, from small, you know, young to older, people from all ethnicities, just so much diversity. And for me, that's a standout moment. Every week's a standout moment because I'm just so thankful for what God's doing in this place.
You get a clap. I've got a cheeky standout moment. So years ago, in the early days when we were kind of just transitioning the church into what we saw, really, that we could be. And I remember doing this preaching series called Pentecostal Icons, which is like out there, right? And I was just challenging this thought that we look at the high church and we call and we, you know, criticize, or they do this ceremonial thing. And I'm like, we're just the same. We're just the same. And it was this particular Sunday we did communion, and I thought we need to show that it's about what it's about and not what we use, okay? So we would normally have Jacob's crackers back in the day and Ribena, right? So I said to the guys, this week we're going to do communion, and I want you to go and buy a load of brownies and bottles of Coke. So we turned up on Sunday morning, we celebrated Jesus and commemorated his death with brownies and Coke. Does anybody ever remember that? If you give me you're not going to admit to being here on that morning. And it was really just to show, you know, guys, it's not about what we take, but it's about what it means. And that's just that was just a standout moment, really, for me. And one last quick standout moment would be, obviously, you've got to talk about the opening of the site, okay? When we built this and all the time that it took and what have you. And on that day, some of you will remember my father and my mother did the opening. Yeah. Steve Matthew alluded to it a couple of weeks ago when he was doing the talk. And I think it was just so special, particularly for me, in the fact that that moment, okay, so it was about the opening of the building and all the hard work that had been put in. But more than that, it was about honoring my mum and dad. And it was kind of, for me, without going into the whole story, a point of reconciliation, which was a very special moment for me as well.
Good, very good. Who thinks we should do brownies and Coke every communion? Can I get an amen?
Can I say something on that before you continue? Is that, so I got a call off, because I was a youth leader at the time under Dave, and I got a call from Deanery High School to say, one of the pupils that goes to your church has put in his exam that what do people take for Holy Communion? Cookies and Coca-Cola.
Come on!
And we know about your church. Is that true? And I was like, yeah, give him the point. Okay, and he passed the test. All right, so what you might not know is that Dave has had a stonking career even before taking on the senior leadership chair of this church. And one of his finest career moments is creating and releasing his own album.
With his siblings and his family.
It was a whole family affair. And he took it on tour around the world. And it still is a big deal, okay? So tell your friends. And I think what we've got is maybe a little bit of a taster
of
what that sounded like.
No.
Who would like to hear it?
I'm so glad you got it. So
play the music, guys. Let's do it. And let's listen.
Is it just a figment of imagination?
Or is it just...
Or is it just a story
that you've heard?
We all know it. Come on, let's go.
Yeah.
Here we go.
Oh, listen, that's me.
Can I just say it sold thousands of copies around the world?
I know we're kind of...
Maranatha.
Oh, come on.
Maranatha.
Come on, you know.
Jesus is coming.
Don't make it a theological
point. Get your lights out, come on.
Morning.
Come on, get your phone lights out, come on.
Any day now. Any day now.
You're so kind.
Jesus is coming.
I think you must play this at the pearly gates. It feels so weird and surreal that I'm
here.
Okay, so, thank you guys. But you might not know that Dave went on to release a few more albums that you might not know about. One including Heads. So here's his next big hit. This is his second album. Can we get it on screen, guys? So this is called Has the Geek Faith. And it sold over 10 copies in Wigan. And then we've got his follow-up album, which I personally love, and it's called On the Water with Jesus.
Where are these pictures from?
The story goes he recorded that while stood on the water, but no one's there. And finally, we have one from Dave and Helen together. This is the final album called Family on Mission, which they did together. And we have created CDs, and we're going to give you one all after the gathering. No, I'm joking, not really.
And we actually wish that we'd thought ahead and done that, to be honest. But thank you very much to Dave's wonderful mother, Barbara, for supplying us with the LP to be able to do that.
Thanks for that, Mum.
So we'll move back. We'll go more serious. We'll move back to the questions. That's fine. This is actually one that I wanted to ask because over the years, I don't. If you've been around a while, even if you're not, but probably if you've been here more long term, you might recognise some messages. When you think of Dave, like standout messages that he's brought or series, and I was interested to find out what you think, what those were for you. Maybe three standout ones.
Okay. For those of you who've been coming long enough, you know that I only ever preach one message. It's the truth about potential of people's lives. So that's just been brought in different ways over the years. One standout one to me, because I think it really helped the church, is a good number of years ago now, called Generational Sameness. Does anybody remember that? And just this whole thought of, you know, the just sameness that comes in life, and sameness has to be changed. And I just spoke about breaking that containment, because sameness contains us, right? And we live in a town where there's a lot of sameness, but some of you have actually changed the culture that's in the town by the nature of generational sameness and shifting from where it was. That was a big deal.
Yeah.
What else?
I mean, one that this might be completely irrelevant, right? But hopefully someone remembers this. I don't remember what the series is about. I think it might have been Land of the Giants. And he said, "Oh no, not the Nephilim." No, does anybody remember that?
I think that was a television program you were watching.
No, seriously, do you remember that, Rage? I knew I hadn't made it up. Anyway, go on, that's just my fave. Go on. I don't know what it was about either. I just liked the voice he did. He really impacted me over the years.
Thanks, Anna. Does anybody remember? Here's one. Will the real you please stand up? Okay, which really was about taken from the life of King David, and when he was going to fight Goliath, and the whole narrative of where he's with Saul, and Saul's trying to get him to wear his armor, and this really was about not trying to live to the expectations that others have put on your life. You know, wear this. you need to wear this. I kind of felt that in my life many, many years ago now when I was younger, you know, from family, from church community. This is what you need to look like, pastor. Well, how many know that I ditched the word pastor straight away? And it was not living to the expectations of others, but being the real you that God created you to be and flourishing in who God's called you to be. So that was a special kind of talk, yeah, really. And then I suppose the real standout one would be events versus environments. You know, this is now still obviously something. There's some talks that you give. There are some things that come of revelation. And the whole idea that we're not just about events and creating events, even though we create great events, but about life being an environment. You know, you can't take this event to work tomorrow morning, but you can take the environment of your life. And if we shape those environments, we can then be not only who we are here, but everywhere else in the marketplace. That's where the thing came from, that we create irresistible environments where people can find their way back to God. That's not just about now, that's about tomorrow morning when you're at work. And so that was a very shaping thing for the church.
Brilliant.
At the time.
Yeah, excellent. As we kind of reflect a little back, what are the couple of things you've learned about leading? Maybe I'll start with you, Helen, if that's okay. What are some things that you've kind of learned along the way that might give us an insight to what it was like?
I think probably one I've learned a lot more recently. I think we all learn lessons, don't we, whether you're in leadership or just life, which is leadership. But anyway, is listening well. So listen to people, listen to what people are saying, and sometimes listen to what people aren't saying. And listen to God. You know, if you're of faith, listen to what God's saying to you. Something else I've learned is to live with open hands. You know, sometimes we have things and we want to hold on to them. The best way to live, in my opinion, is to live with hands like this. You know, what you get can transfer out to other people, and that's important in life. Another thing which I've learned, which is probably more sort of in the position we've held, is to keep a soft heart but a hard skin, because sometimes, and that's for everybody, isn't it, in life, no matter what you're doing, but to keep your heart soft before God. Sometimes you have to toughen up a bit on the outside because perhaps people say some things to you or you don't like some stuff, but to keep your heart soft all the time. If your heart's soft, you're open to what God can say to you.
Yeah. So Helen texts me in the house this morning.
We don't speak much.
I got this. She was upstairs getting ready. I was already ready, and she texts me saying, "Do you want me to send you my notes of what I'm going to say?" I said, "Yeah, if you want." Like, so she sent me the notes, and I read this stuff. I'm like, "That's really good." I said, "It's better than mine." I texted her back, "It's better than mine." She said, "It's not a competition, Dave." I know that, Aunt. I realise that. Something I've learned is don't say it can't happen. Don't say it can't happen. I was told many, many times from different people, different aspects of church life, what could happen, what couldn't happen in this town. And, you know, Wigan is a proof. This church community is a proof that don't say it can never happen, because Wigan proved that it could. And there's so much I could say about that. I leave that to your own kind of thoughts and imaginations. But Wigan is the proof that don't say it can never happen. God can do what you'll allow him to do, you know, and what you can assist him to do in that sense. There's one thing I've learned. Do you want more or not? Is that?
We've got more questions.
Okay, well, go for questions.
We've got one more question.
Yeah, cool.
Before kids, you're doing so well. Thank you, parents, as well. I know it's difficult when you've got kids in. The final question is, if you had to sum up your experience of the last 25 years in one word, I know it's difficult, what would it be? And then maybe a brief explanation of why you picked that word. You can choose between you who goes first. It's not a competition.
It's not a competition. No, it's not a competition, but I'll go first.
Thanks, Ruben. We knew.
Lots of words you can think of, but the word that I came up with was full. I think
I've been part of this church community in a different location since I was 19. That's coming up to 40 years. I know it doesn't look it. And my life turned around when I became a Christian, when I found Jesus for myself. So that was the start of my journey. And I think my life from then, and obviously leading here for the past 25 years and before in different sort of youth or what have you, just been enriched by you guys, you people, you know, because for me, it's been a privilege to be a part of some of your lives, some of the things, you know, the ups and downs of life. Life's never a straight line, is it? There's lots of bumps, some difficult times, really difficult times, and there's some really joyful times. And my life's been enriched by that, because it's not just about me, it's about our lives together as a community. So full, yeah, full.
Excellent. Yeah, so my word, I'd kind of come up with two, because I had just one, but I...
Of course you did.
Okay, so the first word that I came up with was interesting, you know. I think over 25 years, it's kind of interesting, you know. Interesting. Everything. There's a story behind all of those things, of course, of the interesting way that God has done some things. And one thing I could say within that interesting thing is that I understand that, and I believe that God is more interested in what he's trying to do in us than what he's trying to do through us. And that's been my experience, that it's like, you know, whatever the church is coming into, God has taken me through. He's taken us through first. That's been a pattern of the last 25 years, if not the last 36 years, actually, that we've been on staff. And it's kind of, that's rolled out, that the stuff that God's done in me, and I'm like, I know this is going to happen to the church now, and it has every single time. Second word I would say is evolution, not a word you hear much in church community. You know, after our revolution all those years ago, it's been evolution. I've said all along, change is here to stay. And I think this church community has got to where it has because it's had the ability to change. And I would say evolution doesn't stop here. It continues to change. What we are today, we will not be in 12 months' time. It continues beyond our tenure, if you like. And so evolution would be another word.
That's great. It's been a wonderful and it's been a privilege to be part of a community that you both have led so fantastically. And not only is it a celebration about what you've achieved and what we've achieved, but it's also a celebration as we look ahead, not just for you guys obviously still being part of our church community, but the wonderful things God's going to do outside of here to the nation and the nations as well. And I know there's many people watching online and will watch this back from all over the place. So we have just a small gift of appreciation for you guys, just to say thank you. And some flowers and wine.
Thank you. That's
you shouldn't
lovely.
Have told them what it was. They'll all want some.
Yeah, it's true that.
Holy communion, anybody?
Okay, I think that's it for this section. And we're going to be praying and hearing some more stories a little bit later on. But I think it's time that we thank Dave and Helen and let them go and sit back down.
Thanks, guys.
Okay, so you can take your seats and just get comfy for a minute and enjoy the music that's about to play. As part of our dedication to Dave and Helen is that we want to make sure that they've given us the best of their years, and we want to show honour and appreciation and generosity that they have modelled in their own life. So you'll see on the screen, we're taking a special love offering today that goes straight to Dave and Helen, and it goes straight from you to them. So that's why we set it up in this way. So all you got to do is hold your phone up to the screen and the QR code. If you click on that, it'll take you directly to an online giving page. And we're actually going to spend the next couple of minutes just with this here for you to give and contribute. Thanks so much to the many, many people that have given so far. I know that
Dave and Helen are going to be really blessed by your generosity, so thank you. And as well, your giving is as anonymous as you want it to be. You know, you don't need to put your name on there. It can, or you could write a message. Quite a few people have written messages already on that site that they will feel encouraged by. Or alternatively, you could put your name on and someone else's bank details. So however it works for you.
And as you are doing that, we'll literally just give you one more minute. As you're doing that, don't forget, or you might have noticed, that there is little postcards on the seats around you that say Celebration Sunday on them. We wanted you to write a message to Dave and Helen or a story, maybe anything you want. And you can do that, and then you can pop those in the baskets, which will be at the back of the room after the gathering, and we'll make sure they get those.
Yeah, what we'll do is we'll compile those postcards, and we're going to put them in a big scrapbook, and we're going to give it to Dave and Helen to keep. So watch your language on that, okay? Because it will be on public record, okay? So make sure you pop it in the baskets there. Guys, I think we should listen to a little bit of music. You know, just play a little bit, just in the background. It just helps people give. That's it. Come on. Come on.
And I mean, the great thing about this is we can actually send it you and you can listen to it seriously.
Yeah, Gavin and the guys have put them all on MP3 format. So we won't send them out to you because we're not sure what copyrights are in place, who owns that record, but we'll send it to the creators of that. And as well, after the gathering, if you haven't had a cake pop already, there's one for you after the gathering. If you've already had one, then Maranatha, okay? You need to make sure someone else gets the blessing. I think that's about it, isn't it?
Yeah, I think we should let the kids go to kids' church. I think that would be great for the kids and the parents. So have a fantastic time. And we are going to carry on celebrating Dave and Helen very soon.
Roll of ET. Thank you.
Children can see where their age group are gathering. Your child should already be booked in and ready to go. Okay, kids, on the count of three, make your way to the kids' church leaders. Are you ready, Shapers and X? Three.
Well, good morning, everybody. My name's David, and yeah. I mean, normally, if I'm talking to people, I don't prepare notes. I wing it. You know, anybody who knows me knows that. But given what happened to the Prime Minister this week, I thought I'd better prepare notes. And not only have I prepared notes, I've numbered them so I don't lose the page. I'm assuming most of you watch the news occasionally. And saw the drama there. Anyway, so let's just start, shall we? You know, it's such a privilege and an honour to be able to say a few words to about Dave and Helen. They have been so. I'm off my notes already. I can't stick to them. They've been so special to us as a family. Anyway, Ben just said when I was coming up, I need to tell people who I am, because so many new people come in church the last, particularly through COVID and the last few years. I had prepared that in my notes. So let me just remember. So my name's David as well, and my family are here with me. So Jane, my wife, you may know her more. She's been serving and leading kids' church for many, many years. We first came here 16 years ago. And also today, I've got my two daughters, Joy and Grace, and my very tall, Dibrel Cisse-looking son, Daniel. So let's try and get to my notes, shall we? Because they are quite good, if I can read them. Yeah. So I serve here at TCC as a director on the board, and I'm a business guy. I love Jesus, and I love this church, and it's been amazing. And you know, there are two big things for me. You know, the reason we've been able to be as a family successful in life is because we love Jesus, but also because we've got excellent leaders that we've been inspired with and who we're following. Anyway, that's not on my notes either, so I need to try and get back to them. You know, it's been amazing, actually, how we've been on a faith adventure here in church. And part of the thing I've been doing is serving with Dave on the building team and the building project. It actually started, I think it's about 11 years ago now, because we've been in this building for 3 since it got finished, and I definitely know it took 8. And it was really tough. It was tough in terms of it needed so many breakthrough moments and really things that were impossible in the natural that happened along the way. And, you know, I've been involved in quite a few projects in life, but this has been the toughest one. And it's been so good for me personally to follow Dave's leadership in it. There was a standout moment, actually, for me that sort of defined how I understand leadership a few years ago. And basically, we were at a point with it, some of you will remember this, where this building didn't exist. It was all land, but we'd refurbed the other building. And basically, it was a moment where Dave said, we had about £1 million in the bank, and Dave said, right, what we're going to do is we're going to spend it all and refurb that building. And I was stood with him and I said, I don't think we should do that. I think we should try and get the money off the bank in place. And he said, no, we've just got to go forward and get on with it. And we had a bit of a disagreement, to be honest. And Dave said to me, look, you know, I've got to make the call, and it's up to you if you want to follow. And it was brilliant for me, that, in life, because I decided to follow. I thought, and I realized that fundamentally, when you're doing something, no one can walk in the shoes of the person who's got the absolute call to make. And Dave's leadership at that moment in time was spectacular, and the fruit of it is here now. And that is a big deal. And you know, anyway, let me tell you about Dave and Helen. Dave and Helen have poured their lives out for the sake of the church. They've been married for 34 years. They've been serving as senior leaders for 25, and I think it's more than 10. It's quite a bit prior to that. You know, Dave knew that when he took on the role of senior leader, that God was calling him to break the mold. For those of you into Star Trek, he was to go boldly where no man has gone before. And if you want some Bible, Joshua 3:4 says, then you will know which way to go, since you have never been this way before. You see, Dave is a man with a vision. He saw and sees a healthy, thriving, multi-generational community that's relevant to the world around it. A community that's known for its love for one another and is capable of shifting the culture. He said some of this before, but this is what I prepared. Now, Dave, if we talk about theology for a second, he believes in an ever-advancing kingdom. You see, there are many people who believe that it's actually, things are going to get worse, and it's going to be kind of like we need a siege mentality. Basically, you know, it's not for him, that idea of the world's going to hell in a handbag. You know, that's not how he believes that the kingdom's going to get better and better. And you know, that's one of the foundations that Dave and Helen have built this church on. Dave believes in the blessed life. He believes in the Jesus who invites us into the promised land. it's a land flowing by. I'm preaching now, aren't I? I've never done that before. It's a land flowing with milk and honey. It's a land full of big bunches of grapes. That is what he has been modelling. That's what's been in his heart. And you guys get the benefit. You know, that's the environment that he has created, and it's based on his revelation of who Jesus is. You know, we as a family have been delighted to follow these last 16 years, and I want to say that Dave has inspired me consistently year in and year out. You know, for those of you who don't know Dave, he isn't just a church leader, preacher man. He's also a passionate artisan builder. You could even call him a carpenter. You know that. And he totally loves buildings and design and architecture. But God called him to build people first. He actually called him to put the tools down and prioritize building the church and building the people. But isn't it amazing how God works? Because the symmetry of that is he then had the privilege of seeing a spectacular building built at the same time. But you need to know it's people first with Dave. That's what it's been, and that's why, you know, that is the priority. This facility is just a container so we can see more people impacted and reached. And you know, the Edge, really, it's our gift to the people of Wigan, and it's quite amazing to be part of it. You know, it's hard not to, when you're sort of trying to prepare this little couple of minutes, it's hard not to focus on the major accomplishments that Dave and Helen have achieved. However, underneath that, they are people of high integrity. You know, with Dave, I could pick out many qualities. You know, he has a gift of faith. He's got a gift of wisdom. His courage, his bravery. But actually, I'd like to highlight his kindness and his consistency as a friend. It's been a precious gift to me. And one moment has come to mind recently where about 4 years ago, I was going through a horrible situation in business. And Dave just stood and kind of held me. And he probably doesn't know how significant and important he was to me at that time. But he was a complete rock for me. And so I was really under the pump and struggling. And then one day he rang me and said, look, I've been out doing my morning prayer walk. And he gave me a word from God. It actually made the difference. You know, Dave's a man of prayer who walks with Jesus. And Dave and Helen have laid a foundation in TCC that the next generation are going to build on. You will build the kingdom bigger, better, with more influence. And that's how it should be. I just want to say, Dave, that and Helen, that we as a family, and me in particular, we love you. And we want to thank you for your service, and we salute you.
Amazing. Thanks for that, Dave. Wow, that was pretty much a sermon, I would say. That was great. I love it. Okay, so my name's Rachel. I'm part of the leadership team here, but many of you will know this, but maybe many of you won't. I'm the eldest daughter of Dave and Helen. So I'm going to kind of tell you a few stories and a few tales, some to do with being a daughter, but mainly to do with working. First of all, with Dave, and then I'm going to say some stuff about my mum. So one of the questions I still get asked the most, not necessarily in this context, but when I meet different people, two things. What's it like working with your dad? And secondly, why do you call your dad Dave? So the first one, I just want to address, why I call my dad Dave, that was just more of a work thing when we first started working together. Anyway, so that, there's not really a major reason for that. But the first thing, what's it been like working with my dad? Well, the first week I started working for today's community church and with my dad. I was 19. I was almost 20, and it was great. But the first week, I can't even remember what it was exactly. Maybe, I don't even know if you'll remember this. He set me a bit of an assignment that basically I didn't do by the deadline. Let's just say that was the first and last time that happened. And I remember him telling me off and being like, listen, in this context, like, I am your boss. But the fact is, that was the only time I've ever heard him say that. I should have just been doing what I was told, right? So I got told off for not doing my assignment. So I always feel like when people ask me what it's like to work with my dad, I always want to say, I feel like I'm a realist, so I always want to like find some kind of thing that they're going to enjoy that's a bit gritty, like, oh, this is what it's like working with family. But I actually always struggle to, because I absolutely love working with Dave. It's been a pleasure. I think we don't always agree, but we understand each other. He's crying now, so here we go. But it's been an absolute blast. And so working with my dad, for me, I know it's not for everyone, working with family doesn't always work. For us, it's just been amazing, a privilege. I want to tell you some key things about my dad, or about Dave, which I think are really important. First of all, his adaptability. His ability to adjust and adapt is amazing, especially for a man who always orders fish and chips when he goes out to eat and never picks anything else off the menu, or is convinced that the only type of wine he likes is red wine. I'm like, Dad, branch out. So for someone who is very set in his ways in some odd things, he's an incredibly adaptable man. And yeah, he always says I go on about his age, but for someone who's nearly 60, this is actually next year. This is a big deal. So to maybe other people in his generation, you know, we get a certain way of thinking and the way we like things. And what I would say about Dave is, especially in the context of church and the kingdom of God, he's been willing to sacrifice himself and to change and to listen to those younger than him, because he wants to learn. As much as he's led this community, he's a lifelong learner as well. And so his ability to adapt and to lead here is also why we have the kind of community we have here, because he's been willing to change and not just stick with the style he likes or the thing he likes, but he's been able to be soft and adapt. The second thing is that he's really great at empowering others. Somebody else has said this on stage. Dave's been really good at reminding us as a team that we're not as young as we think we are. And they're actually always asking, like, who are the younger ones, or who are the other people, maybe from an older generation, that you're investing into, that you're giving your best to, and that you're empowering and helping them find their place as well and be the best that God's called them to be. Another one is very authentic. So whether that's like, we somewhere in the office have a little American football, and sometimes if you're not careful, it will fly past your head and you wonder what's going on. You're just innocently doing your work and a football flies past your head. Okay, it's usually Dave distracting everybody from doing their best work. So whether he's doing that or whether he's coming to a meeting and it's like, I'm having a bad day today, guys. Like, I'm just wearing my heart on my sleeve. I don't want to be here today. Those days are fewer, but whatever it is, he just comes before people as an authentic person, where he's at, where he's feeling. He's not trying to be anything he's not, anyone he's not, and he's not impressed by somebody trying to pretend they're somebody they're not as well. But that's been a great gift to us as a team, but as to this community as well, and to me as a daughter. And then last little thing about Dave, before I just say something about my mum, who I never call Helen, by the way. She's weird. I call my dad Dave, I don't call my mum Helen. My mum's just mum, right? Dave has been amazing at honouring people, and he will continue to. And I don't just mean that in terms of speaking well of them all the time, although he does do that. But I've had the privilege, I guess, as a child, but also as somebody working closely with Dave, I've seen him many, many times honour people when he could have been justified not to. I've seen him take the high road many times, and there's stories that will never be told, and there'll be more that I don't know about as well. But taking the high road where you could have been justified to, you know, take his ball home or kick off or expose something. And I'm just so grateful that, because honor is at the core of who you are, Dad, That's also reflected in this community. We're not perfect, and you know, obviously we know Dave and Helen are not perfect, but that has been a hallmark of this community. It's been a hallmark of our staff, that we want to honour people and we want to honour God, which means this is not just about our feelings or us being justified. Like, no, we know God is no man's debtor, and we're going to trust God and we're going to honour people. So, a few things about my dad. And then mum... My mum is a nonconformist, right? And it's the greatest gift I think she's probably ever given to me, apart from my sisters, because that was a great gift as well. She doesn't like to mainly do what she's told. And she was talking about how long she, you know, how long ago she came to faith before. I remember my mum telling me a story when she was, I don't know, maybe when she first started going to church. In those days, it's like, if you're a woman and you show up on a Sunday, you better be wearing like a dress and a hat. Kind of vibe. Clearly today that's not where we're at anymore. I'm literally wearing jeans and trainers and a sparkly top. But my mum would wear dungarees, right? That was the thing. She was just like flying in the face of tradition. And my mum has always been like that. I'm so grateful that she's never had to assume a role or a responsibility, or she's never had to stand on a stage, although I think she did amazing this morning, actually. But she's never had to stand on a stage. But many people in this room and online, and many, many, many more who are not with us anymore, have moved away, can attest to the love and the true pastoral support and care that they've had from Helen and the wisdom she shared on stage today. She's not been stood on a stage doing that, but she's been doing that behind the scenes for years and decades. And so, yeah. So we are beneficiaries of that, and we will continue to be beneficiaries of that. There are a million things I could say, but just to say, I'm really excited for you guys for this next season, and I'm looking forward to calling you dad more. That's it. Thank you. Oh, no. That's actually not it from me. Okay. So the fun part, our media team have worked so hard on this Sunday, but they have prepared something very exciting for us now, for Dave and Helen, but you guys are going to get a right laugh out of it as well. So it's funny, it's emotional, it's all of those things. So we're going to pop the lights down and please watch this, what is essentially a highlight video. Thank you.
Hey Dave and Helen, congratulations on 25 years leading today's community church. Well done.
Ahoy Dave, Helen, you are my heroes, guys.
You've really set the church up well for the future, and you've done such a fantastic job. Real breakthrough, achieved so much.
You've brought a lot to our community, to Czech churches.
And I also want to thank you from Trish and myself for being great friends. When I needed a mate, Dave, you were there for me. And you guys have been just amazing. We really love you, we appreciate you, we believe in you, and here's expecting great things in this new season.
You are a huge blessing for us. Thank you for making me and Lenka part of your family.
These are some of the words to describe David and Helen. Well done. Well done, good and faithful servants.
I appreciate you guys so much.
Thank you so much for being a great mate. Bless you.
Most of all, you're my brother and you're my sister-in-law.
Not many of you will know that I am David's mum. Some of you will. But he calls me Mumsy, my special name. He was born in Perth, Australia, in 1962 on November the 4th. I remember when Dad handed over the leadership of this church to David, he was 32. And now 25 years later, I look back with pride at what has happened and the amazing things that are going on now in the church. One of the highlights to me was when he married Helen. She has stood by him, and in the bad times and the good times, and his lovely four daughters. And I'm proud to be not only a mom, a mother-in-law, but a grandmother. And now for Ben and Hannah and the two children, I want you to support them, pray for them and love them. They're taking on a big responsibility, and I want you to know that I am behind them 100%. God bless this church, and God bless Ben, Hannah, and the children.
Helen, can we show our appreciation, our love? Please stay standing. I appreciate there's been a lot of talking, especially online. We're going to have a minute to sing together and really honour God and thank Him for these two wonderful people in our church community. But first, I think it's time that we pray. Shall we pray for our leaders in the house? So I'm going to ask the directors, the board of directors of TCC and the leadership team, if they wouldn't mind just gathering round. Dave and Helen, do you guys want to just come forward here and just create a bit of space? That's it. Steve Roddick, who's one of our longest standing board members with Dave, is going to lead us in a prayer together. And I just encourage you all, stretch out your hands. Pray your own prayer for them. Thank God for them. And thank you, Steve.
And Daddy, I just thank you for Dave and Helen. I just thank you for their faithfulness and their passion to just follow the vision that you gave them for this church in Wigan. Thank you that they've been consistent and that they've just pushed through with everything that you've asked them to do. But more than that, Lord, I thank you that they're ambassadors for your kingdom, and they just show a real heart of integrity for all that they do. I just thank you for that, Lord. And Lord, as they move on now into the next chapter of their adventure with you, I ask that you would bless them with more of your presence, with more of your grace, and that you just excite them for all that you have for them. There's so much more that you have for them still to come. So I ask that you would bless them in that, and that you would hedge them around with your protection, both them and their family. I ask that in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Thank you, guys. I appreciate that. I think it's time that we sing together and we honor God for the great gift that He gave to us with Dave and Helen, and the gift they'll continue to be. So let's sing together. Let's enjoy this moment, and let's thank God for all He's done and who He is. Thanks, Ben.
Amen. Thanks, guys. You know, it's been a fantastic morning so far. We thought we'll make it even better and we'll bring a new song to you. So hopefully that'll be a bit of a treat. I just wanted to share a scripture with you before we sing this new song. It's in Matthew 6, and I'm reading it in the Message version because it just really brings across what I want to say. And you know, it's basically talking about how beautifully created the wildflowers are and how God really just kind of puts attention to detail. And it says, "If God gives such attention to the appearance of wildflowers, most of which are never even seen, don't you think He'll attend to you, take pride in you, do His best for you?" What I'm trying to do here is get you to relax, to not be so preoccupied with getting so you can respond to God's giving. People who don't know God and the way he works fuss over these things, but you know both God and how he works. Steep your life in God reality, God initiative, God provisions. Don't worry about missing out. You'll find your everyday human concerns will always be met. And you know, the song that we're singing, we use this word Jireh. If you've read scripture before, you might have heard Jehovah Jireh, which means God who provides. So I just think of Jireh as we sing it as saying provider. And you know, we'll have seen this in Dave and Helen's life, and that's exactly what we've been talking about this morning. We've been talking about how they've provided for this church, they have led this church. And you know, most importantly, and those two will always say this, that it's through God that they've been able to do that. It's through God being a provider. So you know, as we sing this song this morning, I hope it blesses you. And let's just really go into this time of worship together and really think on that. He is our provider.
I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Wasn't holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you down. It doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right now.
Going through a storm, but I won't look down. I hear your voice carried in the rhythm of the wind to call me out.
You would cross an ocean
so I wouldn't drown. Be closer than you are right now.
Well, let's lift it up. Sing Jireh.
Jireh, you are enough. Jireh, you are enough. Sing, I will be content in every circumstance. Jireh, you are enough. Forget how I feel right now on the mountaintop. I can see so clear what it's all about. Stay by my side when the sun goes down.
I can imagine, and that is enough.
more than enough. Yes, declare tonight, forever enough, always enough, more than enough. Oh yeah, forever enough, always enough, more than enough.
Great. surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with the fullness of God. Now, to who is able to do so much more than we can ever ask, imagine, according to his power in work in us. To him be the glory.
Hallelujah.
In the church and in Jesus Christ throughout all generations. Hallelujah. Forever. Amen. And the people of God said amen, amen, amen. Be the glory. Oh, do you know, you can come to a family celebration like this, but I don't want you to miss that this extraordinary moment where we celebrate a life well lived has been lived by every single day of ordinary things done well. Let's not underestimate what it is to be faithful in the seen and the unseen, and to do well with a little. God can breathe on that and bless on that. And if you're here and you go, I want to know what it is to encounter a love like that, that shapes and brings a community together that aren't naturally brothers and sisters and parents, but there is something that the love of Christ brings them into a family and into a union that can change a nation. In Jesus' name, I want to encourage you, if that's you and you go, I really want to know this Jesus that can shape and impact a life that has a love that overflows like this. There is a team that would love to pray with you. Here, if you're here in the arena, they'll just be there in the back corner. If you want to know Jesus, if you want to kind of ask what could be the next steps for you, just make your way there. The team would love to pray with you, offer you a Bible, and help you look for what are the next steps for you. If you're online, there'll be a hand prayer emoji, or just put in a hand emoji. We would love to just help you figure out what does it look like for you to come into a relationship with Jesus and have his love transform you. And so we want to encourage you to do that. But you know what? It's been an incredibly special morning. I don't know if you agree. And don't forget, because I know you'll all be stirred up with stories of, and I feel like they're flooding back to my mind, of just how the impact this incredible couple have, and we want to thank them and bless them. Write your story down. Scripture says that, you know, we're to build one another up with our encouragement and our words. So there is a story card on your seats. Write it in. You can put it there. Some baskets at the back of the arena as you leave. Pop them in just before you go. But we also have an opportunity to give them a love offering. And if that's you and you want to kind of participate in that, we have a hub, which is our information point, just at the back of the arena. The QR code will be there. You can kind of scan that in again if you had trouble doing that earlier. If you also want to give by cash, you can do that. You can put it in the envelope at the hub and just simply address it to Dave and Helen, and we'll make sure that it gets to them. But it is almost as if heaven wanted to go, I'm going to put a little bit of icing on this. I'm going to dust this with my blessing. It has been snowing, guys. So it has, well, we've been tucked up all warm. Heaven's kind of dusted everything with a nice bit of frosting for you. So just be careful, it might be a little bit slippy underfoot, but why not stay and share your story with someone else and encourage these guys. Thanks for sharing a really special time with us. Thanks, guys. Take care.